I would like to call a regular meeting of the Board of Trustees, August 13, 2019, to order. Would you kindly join the board and myself in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Clerk Bruce, would you kindly call the roll?
Trustee Barr.
Here.
Trustee Cuevas.
Here.
Trustee Manso.
Here.
Trustee Syed.
Here.
Trustee Tezinger. Trustee Youssef.
Here.
And President Lamalani.
Here. Opening comments. First, the Athlete of the Year Awards. We have a proclamation to be read for the Athletes of the Year. I would like to ask Kayla Byrne and Ethan Harast, both from Hinsdale Central High School, to please come forward. I believe one of them is
they're
here.
Both here.
Yeah?
They're both here.
Okay. They're both here. Very good. Yeah.
Oh, good.
Very good, yeah. The Athlete of the Year Award was initiated by Paul Butler in 1974 and has been awarded by a committee of the Oak Brook President's Club. Each year, the athletic directors from 9 public and private high schools serving Oak Brook are asked to nominate an outstanding senior girl and boy who participated in a lettered individual or team sport. This year, Kayla Byrne won the award for her exceptional participation in cross-country and track, and Ethan Harast won for the exceptional participation in baseball. Clerk Bruce, would you kindly read the proclamation?
Proclamation. Whereas the Oak Brook Athletic of the Year Award Program was initiated by Paul Butler and awarded by the Oak Brook President's Club since 1974. And whereas each year the athletic directors of 9 public and private high schools serving Oak Brook are asked to nominate an outstanding senior female and male who participated in a lettered individual or team sport. And whereas this year Kayla Byrne was nominated from Hinsdale Central High School and awarded Oak Brook Athlete of the Year for her exceptional participation in cross country and track over her 4 years of high school. And whereas this year, Ethan Harst was nominated from Hinsdale Central High School and awarded Oak Brook Athlete of the Year for his extraordinary participation in baseball over his 4 years of high school. Now, therefore, I, Gopal G. Lamalani, by virtue of the authority vested in me as president of the Village of Oak Brook, do hereby proclaim and recognize these 2 outstanding athletes of 2019. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and seal this 13th day of August, 2019. End of proclamation.
Thank you. You've been waiting for this all year. Is there anybody from the Park District here? Are the parents here? Please come forward as well. Thank you. So we can take a few pictures here. Next item is a resolution in support of the public challenge of the proposed consent order in the case of People of the State of Illinois versus Sterigenics. As you know, the Village Board has been following this contamination issue affecting Willowbrook and the immediate surrounding communities for several months, and several of our residents have come here and spoken up, as well as many of them have emailed me and many of our trustees, concerned about this contamination that has affected in the neighboring community that we live in. We have taken an active role, as a matter of fact, on this issue. I've had several communications and meetings with the mayor from Willowbrook, Frank Trilla, as well as I've met the Cook County Board Chairman, Dan Cronin, and some of the legislators as well, and Illinois House Representative Deanne Mazzocchi. She has taken the leadership on this very serious matter of contamination. It's affected many of our residents in the neighboring community. And we are so honored to have you in our midst today. And if you would like to say a few words about this. Before that, did you have something to say?
You said Cook County, but DuPage County.
DuPage County, yeah. He's got a little bit of Cook, but most of it is DuPage.
Thank you, President Lamlani and the village trustees. Thank you very much. Well, one of the things that we have been working on very seriously in the state legislature had to do with ethylene oxide and how do you manage it, how do you control it, and how do you ensure it's not contaminating our neighborhoods in a way that is unsafe and making people sick. And one of the things that the legislature did was we passed the Matt Haller Act. And that act was designed to keep our communities safe while also making sure that patients and hospitals would not also have to suffer uncertain patient care for very critical surgical instruments. One of the things, though, that we also want to make sure, having done all of the work to ensure that this legislation gets passed, is to ensure that the legislation is actually enforced the way that the legislators intended that it be enforced. One of the things that is of deep concern to the legislators is that the consent order that currently is being proposed by the Illinois Attorney General and the Illinois EPA on the seal order, which is something that unfortunately our DuPage County State's Attorney does not have the ability to control, that one of the things that our state agencies are doing is they are not actually intending to apply the law as written or follow the law to its logical conclusion. And the logical conclusion of that is that the company Sterigenics would have to severely curtail its ethylene oxide use, even if it could manage to comply with the law, which is also something that has not yet been established from our perspective. One of the things, though, that I do want to say is that we very much appreciate the Village of Oak Brook thinking to support our consent order, our opposition to the consent order, to act in support of our amicus brief, and to encourage the judge who is overseeing this case to ensure that our local neighborhoods and our local communities actually do get the benefits of the Matt Haller Act as it was written and as it should be enforced. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your leadership here. And may I now request a motion to approve the resolution in support of the public challenge of the proposed consent order in the case of People of State of Illinois versus Sterigenics.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say yes.
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 Any objections? Motion carried. Thank you again for your help. I'd like to say for a moment that Trustee Tasinga couldn't be here today, but he was the architect of this move to pass this resolution today, and he really almost single-handedly wrote that thing. I know he was in touch with you on this matter, but he wrote it, and I also want to thank Greg for doing some edit work on that, and I think it's close to perfect now, the resolution. And wish you all the best, and hopefully you can save our communities from this contamination.
Yes, and thank you. If anyone does have any questions about it, they are always free to reach out to our office. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for coming this evening. Next, I would like to request Tony Butkowski to kindly introduce the next presentation. Tony?
Good evening. Item 3C is a preliminary board review for a redevelopment project for the Macy's Furniture site at 1717 22nd Street. Mitch Goltz of GW Properties is here this evening to do a brief presentation and summary of a concept plan. GW Properties purchased this property in December 2018. Macy's Furniture will move out of the property at the end of the year and move back to the mall. If this moves forward, the intent is that the existing furniture building will be demolished. It's approximately 110,000 square feet on a 9-acre property. And the concept plan before you here this evening identifies seven specific buildings on the 9-acre site that vary from retail and restaurant uses. This evening, as you know, the preliminary board review of a plan development, the intent is for some initial feedback from the board and questions and comments about the petition, just to give the applicant some direction as they move forward in the formal submittal process. So with that, Mitch Goltz is at the podium to just do a brief presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony, and thank you, Village of Oak Brook and the board and everyone else here to listen to this presentation. As Tony indicated, my name is Mitch Goltz. I am the principal owner of GW Properties. We're a retail investment and development company based in Chicago. We have done projects across the Chicagoland area all the way up to Wisconsin and into Indiana. As Tony indicated, we purchased this Macy's Furniture Building as well as the one in Schaumburg from Macy's Corporation December of last year, with an understanding that they would be leasing back the property for 12 months or so while they relocate back into the mall in their respective cities, which they are hopefully moving diligently on. So as a company, GW has developed over $500 million of real estate in the Chicagoland area. Over the last 5 years, we've done approximately 125 projects. We pride ourselves on being very collaborative with the community and business leaders and tenants and everyone else involved in development, as well as working together to get a great project as an outcome. The property, as you know today, is currently the Macy's Furniture, formerly the Kodak, Eastman Kodak headquarters that long before my day. We have cross access into the Costco property. As Tony indicated, the property currently is a two-story, 110,000 square foot limestone box that's currently been a furniture store for the many years, with a large parking lot abutting 22nd Street, I-88 on the south, and it abuts Route 83 and Costco on the east. As part of the project, we would be doing a complete demolition of the structure and to make way for the new project. This is an overhead aerial. This is also abutting the I-88 on-ramp to the east. As part of the property as it sits today, and we'll get into it once I get into the site plan, the current pavement area is what is being used for the Macy's, as well as cross access to the west into the Macy's, into the Costco lot. For those who were around when this was originally developed, the access point was done here because, my understanding, there was no stoplight going to the Costco at the time, and they needed to use the Macy's property to obtain access for their trucks at the stoplight. As part of this proposed project, we would be redoing the access into the Costco to make it a more seamless approach between the properties, not necessarily to promote the access, but to make it easier for those who are traversing through Costco or into our project. The east end of the property, this area that looks like a giant football field, is actually what's currently being used for underground stormwater, which we would look to maintain in some capacity as part of this project. We would look to pave over it, but in a matter of engineering of the site, which we'll work diligently with staff on, the intention is to leave that not built on for any buildings. There are a bunch of easements running through the property all the way to 22nd Street. The area that's along 22nd up to Route 83, that is currently, shrubs and trees and, slightly below grade, will be raised up and incorporated into the project. This is the current site plan that we're working with, and I want to preface to everyone, we've been working on this for about 12 months with CB Richard Ellis marketing the site in a variety of forms to really field interest in across all, retail, restaurant, entertainment sectors, including tangentially with, some office and alternate uses. Our intent here is to really be complementary to the other projects that are going on in Oak Brook between the Heinz project and what's going on at the mall. And we've been really marketing this very broadly for the last 12 months and have come up with a solution or a project that we believe encapsulates users that are ready, willing, and able to come to our project and speaks to the market demand. Much of what we're looking to do here are restaurants, a limited amount of retail, but the plan is set forth today. Includes currently 7 buildings are proposed on the site, starting all the way from the east, and we'll get into some of the detailed tenants, which I'm able to disclose. We have 5 buildings that are along the street with a nice landscaping setback. Outdoor seating would be available for each of the buildings, with parking, parking field in the middle, along with 2 buildings in the rear, which may end up turning into 3, depending on the final users we end up securing. Cross parking, cross access throughout the project. Right now we have 7 restaurants secured in the front portion, which we'll get into as I get further into the building plans. We'd be maintaining the access in its current form with the stoplight on 22nd Street. We are not looking to make any changes to the access in or out of the site. So a little bit more detailed plan with some dimensions at this juncture. We believe our plan meets all parking codes with the city. We've tried to design it with the landscaping ordinance in mind, which I'll get into. Currently, the building A that's all the way on the east end of the site, on the west end of the site, is a company that we've secured called Lazy Dog Brewery and Restaurant. They're based in California. They're just coming to the Chicagoland market. If you're familiar with the project that was recently completed in Vernon Hills called Melody Farms, that was their first venture into Chicago. That location is doing very, very well. And we were afforded the opportunity to develop a site for them in Northern California as well. And great operation. I have some images and some details on who they are. But we think they'll be a great addition to Oak Brook. Full service, limited service in the mornings, on the weekends, and then lunch and dinner with a very good eclectic menu. The second building, moving to the east, building B is going to be a proposed Panera Bread, which would be an expansion of their facility that they have up to the north, and it would have a drive-through. Panera, who we do a lot of work with, is relocating a lot of their facilities into drive-through facilities to meet their latest prototype. They've seen increases in sales of upwards of 25-35% to locate, with their new prototype and with the drive-through capabilities and more mobile ordering. Building C, as it currently is proposed, is intended to be the multi-tenant building on the project with approximately 11,000 square feet. At present, we have four tenants that we're in the process of securing to make up that building, at least three restaurants and maybe four. Building D, which would be opposite of the stoplight, is a company that we've secured a deal with called Urban Plates out of Southern California. I have some additional detail on what they provide, but it would be a single-tenant building, fresh fusion food that a bit different than what we see in a typical restaurant that we develop. And building E, as it's proposed, is a company called Wildberry Breakfast and Cafe. There's one in Schaumburg. They're in Millennium Park in the city, in the Ritz-Carlton. Very, very, very good operators of primarily a breakfast menu. The buildings in the rear are a little bit more, a little less defined at today's juncture. Building G is proposed in the southeast corner. Could be retail or restaurants. We're in the process of negotiating with a few different restaurants that would occupy that building on a single tenant basis. And then building F is a building that you'll see we're proposing a two-story entertainment restaurant concept, of which we're in talks with a few. In the event that doesn't pan out, we would believe that would turn into probably two other restaurant pads that would tie into the overall project. I'm going to skip ahead here. So as I indicated, the four of the tenants so far that we're able to disclose, Panera, Lazy Dog, Urban Plates, and Wildberry. Building A, we've done some elevations. It's a pretty unique looking building. This is what it looks like in real life. Their prototype, I'm not sure which one this is from, but would expect a similar look, very rustic, unique look. A huge outdoor patio. They're dog friendly, have a lot of TVs, have a great beer list, as they do have a brewery component to it. Highly recommend it. This is some of the food that they've offered. We're very excited, and I think this would be a great addition to the community. Building B would be a proposed Panera. This is their freestanding prototype that they're rolling out across the country. This location in Oak Brook, that's up to the north at 16th, is a very strong location, but they have empirical evidence to show that, as they relocate to where more of the core of the market is with a drive-through, they will see a significant amount of increased sales and ultimate branding to the new identity that they have. They've opened up a new one up in Gurnee and Gurnee Mills that looks great, very sleek, very modern, and definitely a different look than a lot of the Paneras that you may be accustomed to seeing. Building C is still a work in progress as far as where each of the tenants are going to go in that building. But this building, as I indicated, is intended to be up to four tenants. We have a couple tenants secured, one of which is a international sushi concept, not yet in the Chicago market, that operates with a conveyor belt. It's full service. It's a really neat concept that has indicated this would be one of their first two or three locations in the Chicago market. So they're very excited. We have a couple other fast casual concepts, including a barbecue establishment, a Mexican heavy establishment. So we'll be soon able to disclose those tenants. But this building at the light is intended to be multi-tenant in nature. Building D, the design of this building, and I guess I would say all of them, with the exception of Lazy Dog and Panera, are still a work in progress. Some of these tenants are going to want to put their own brand identity. Some of them have their own prototypical buildings, which we haven't yet put on the package. But they'll all be, you know, first-class, unique designs that we think would complement well as a project, but all be a little bit unique in the final details. So this would be Urban Plates. I'd recommend you check out their website. It's in Southern California. They're not yet in Chicago, so this would also be one of their first locations in the market. Full service, mostly dinner and lunch, prepared foods, and you know, salads, sandwiches, some heavier dishes. And then this is Building E, which would be Wildberry. I don't think these elevations are going to be indicative of what they're intending to build, but I haven't been able to get any renderings. We've provided an image of their location in Schaumburg. And they've told me their location in Libertyville would be more indicative of what they would intend to build. Very nice, rustic, a lot of brick, a lot of limestone, and a large outdoor patio. And making me hungry. So Building F on the plan that's shown in the southwest corner is, you know, we're shooting for the stars with getting an entertainment concept. We're in negotiation with one now, which would be a 35,000 square foot live music, entertainment, bar, restaurant component. They're not in the Chicagoland market, so we are working diligently to secure them. This is part of a rollout across the country, and there's still some things to work out. But in the event we don't secure them, we would look to find somebody else of similar caliber. Otherwise, the other option is to convert it to two additional restaurant pads, since we have you know, more restaurants than we have space. And then Building G is also, this is a placeholder for either multi-tenant or a single-tenant building, which is still being secured right now. So, sorry, let's go back. So in total, just a couple highlights. We're going to demolish the buildings we talked about. We expect up to 85,000 square feet of new restaurant, retail, and entertainment spaces, with the majority of that being restaurants. The sales tax, we believe, will be, you know, very significant for the city, far in excess of what's being created today with the Macy's. We'd expect each of the buildings to have their own outdoor seatings exclusive to their customers. You know, parking will be shared throughout. We're looking to promote an eclectic tenant mix to show activity through the day. While we have a lot of restaurants, some of them are breakfast heavy, some of them are lunch heavy, some of them are dinner, and some are just kind of steady as it goes throughout the day. So we believe it'll be a very vibrant, active property throughout all hours of the day. We'll be installing new landscaping throughout. We're going to keep as many trees as we can and create nice screening and buffering throughout the property. You know, we're going to be spending about a $60 million investment into the property with, you know, ongoing investments along the way, and are expecting, you know, hundreds of jobs to be created in the community, both for construction as well as permanent locations. So skipping ahead, sorry to go out of order. Okay, so landscaping plan, we've worked with Manhard Engineering, and they're here in the case there's any technical questions, but you know, we will be trying to maintain as any existing landscaping that's mature as possible. We'll be, you know, installing new landscaping throughout the property, particularly on the perimeters and in the islands, the parking lot, and on each of the pads. We'll work with staff and all village support towards coming up with a nice comprehensive landscaping plan. You know, one of the larger to-dos is to, you know, get the area that's currently just unused, you know, bring that up to grade and make sure the site flows with stormwater properly. We'd also show, you know, parking that would be going kind of in this long, narrow stretch, which we'd envision to be for employees. And if there was any valet, that would be the likely spot to put those vehicles, since it's a little bit further away from the buildings. As far as the signs, it's still a work in progress as well, but what we're intending on doing would be to have a few signs, multi-tenant in nature. You know, the one, you know, expected one would be a masonry structure that would be at the stoplight at the entrance. We're looking at doing, you know, what would be considered more of an icon sign, ideally at the corner of Route 83 and 22nd, just kind of branding the project, and then possibly have one on the rear of the property along ID8, if allowed, just to advertise some of the tenants that, you know, maybe, you know, available for people who are driving on the interstate. But as I said, this is a whole work in progress on the signage. So I've highlighted a few other projects that we've done. You know, no one is more notable than the other, but this is a project that we won a Development of the Year award in Orland Park. It was a former Carson's furniture building that was 165,000 feet. We purchased it with Carson's only. We renovated it and filled it up with entertainment and fitness, and now we're sadly having to deal with filling the Carson's space since they had since closed. This is the one in Bloomingdale at the corner of Army Trail and Gary. It's a 30,000 square foot center. We did a complete renovation on one in Skokie, the former Jack's Diner, which is, if you're from the north side, was a pretty famous spot in Gurnee, and that's about it. So in summary, we're very excited to bring this project forward. We've worked diligently over the last 12 months or so to come up with a plan that we believe speaks to the market as a complementary project to everything going on at the mall in Hines. And I believe the tenants that we will be bringing to this project will fit nicely in the community, be unique, and have up to 8 or 9 restaurants new to Oak Brook. So, happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Yes. John? And then Mike after that.
Yes. We've had quite a few redevelopment projects come before this board, and I believe our staff is very well versed in the board's kind of intent in the direction that we want these projects to go in the way of setbacks, parking, lighting, best standards, bug lighting. So. No up lighting, back lighting, glare, shielded, so that and with screening and landscaping, that this is a very upscale type of redevelopment, something that would fit in with the rest of Oak Brook and the kind of shops that are here. And one of the things we just passed our comprehensive revitalization commercial plan. And one thing that they've always asked us to do is do more along the tollway, which your rear faces the tollway.
Right.
And they've always thought that we should have cross access between the buildings and also, get rid of these chain link fences, which we don't allow, and do more landscaping. So when people drive through there, they see these buildings, they see signage, and they're drawn to your restaurants, they're drawn to your retail development there. So I think that Tony Buzikowski, the development service director, can probably give you good direction in that good direction, period. And I would ask you to listen to his suggestions, because I think he knows kind of what will make this go and what won't be something that's accessible to this board.
Understood, and I appreciate the feedback. And I can tell you, as far as the first couple of comments you had on the engineering, the landscaping, is that we would meet everything to the Village of Oak Brook's code. I mean, anything new that we do is typically state of the art. The lighting, all LEDs, the landscaping. This will be a first class project. It will be high end in nature. And as far as the landscaping or screening along the expressway, I'm all for keeping it exposed. I mean, it's some of the best advertising you could ask for, that some tenants surprisingly don't use that.
And but. Nothing against the other suburbs, fine suburbs, but when you show an example up there, you might want to show Oak Brook and what you've done in Oak Brook,
right,
as your example from now on once this is all done.
Once this project is completed, this will be at the pinnacle of the developments we've completed. I mean, this project, while it's all retail in nature, this is a very high profile site. It's one we're very proud to have been able to acquire, as well as the one in Schaumburg. But I agree, and we've it's all led to be able to do this, and I think we're very excited and proud to be able to bring forward something that would reposition this site that it should have been redeveloped years ago, and we've tried for many years, but it finally was the time, and we want to make sure we get the project right so that this could be last for generations to come. So we will work with Tony and staff to ensure everything is designed in the right standards so that we can all be proud of it once it's
okay.
Done.
Thank you, Mitch.
Thank you.
Mr. Manzo?
I'm very supportive of this project. I think what you've done is a nice complement. Your more casual dining, to complement what Hines is doing, what the mall is doing. But I do have some comments and some concerns. You know, here in Oak Brook, we have a little bit of different problem than our neighbors do. Ours is overdevelopment, right. And we have a lot of developers, a lot of companies that want to come in here. And one of the concerns I'm going to see right off the bat is the setback. With the Hines project, it was a $500 million project. We made some concessions, some variances that we normally wouldn't make, but it was because of the size and the scope of the project. Now everybody's pointing to that project when they're looking at their setbacks, when they're looking at theirs. So I think working with us and trying to find maybe something that's a good compromise as far as setbacks go, I think that would work. We obviously don't want a bunch of outlots or buildings right up on the 22nd. People like the openness they see in Oak Brook, and a bunch of buildings on top of our roads is probably, I think, most residents wouldn't want. But I think we can definitely resolve that and find a happy median for everybody involved. But for years, we've been talking about those corners, and one of them is the southwest corner. And it looks like you have a plan there for some signs. But if we can work and make this an opportunity for both of us to beautify that corner, and I know I've talked to Tony about this. I talked to Bob Colleen when he was here about this. Maybe if we can work in conjunction with you guys, there are millions and millions of visitors that drive by 83 and 22nd. And the northwest corner and the northeast southwest corners really need to be, I think, upgraded and beautified. And this is a great opportunity with your development here.
Thank you. And, you know, I'll go back to that for a moment. And the reason I called it as an icon sign was one of those things that we did discuss with, you know, staff, is that I think there was some discussion on that being ideal to have a sign for Oak Brook. I mean, that was what we intended it to be, you know, kind of a joint effort to advertise the project, but also welcome to Oak Brook. I mean, it could look a lot better than it looks like today. And
yes,
I'm sure we'll work collaboratively in getting something that achieves everybody's objectives.
But I think this is a great project, and it'd be a great asset for our village.
Thank you very much.
Looks good. Any other comments? Then this will move on to the PDC. Tony, am I right?
Yeah, this is the first step, obviously, and this is a conceptual plan. So we intend on working with GW Properties to, have the project evolve a little and then do a transmittal meeting, which then ultimately turns into a formal submittal.
Yeah, thank you. Very exciting. Thank you.
Thank you. And actually, one more point on the timing. So Macy's is supposed to leave, hopefully, end of November, assuming they can get their permits and constructed in their new space. So our goal is to be able in a position where we can demolish the structures as soon as they're out, and then be in a position come, you know, early 2020 to start going onto the site work to start delivering. Our tenants are very eager to get open next year, as we would like to do the same. So
thank you
very much, and happy to answer any questions anybody has.
Thank you. Next is a presentation of a resolution to 2019 AGLE EXL R11820, a resolution appointing a new village attorney, Artisan Britt Skelly Cooper Gilbert and Denolfo Limited, as village attorney, and approving an engagement agreement. As you know, the board from time to time reviewed the operating procedures that we have, and we haven't had an RFP or request for proposal, as it means, for legal services for several years. So we did send one out in June. And we did have five firms that were interested and responded. And subsequent to that, the legal committee met, co-chaired by Trustee Manzo and DeSinger. And the members include many of the people who are on the dais here, including Trustee Asif Youssef, Moin Syed, and Phil Cuevas. Mike Manzo co-chaired it, and Joan Mullins is one of the residents who is on the committee as well. And I also want to thank Rick Janex and Tony Butkowski. They also participated during the interview process. Out of this interview process came recommendations from the legal committee to pick three firms. I was afforded three firms. And out of these three firms, I did interview two of them that were the top on our list. And I'm now making a recommendation that the board would consider the approval, the engagement agreement with Artisan, Brits, Kelly, Cooper, Gilbert, and Denolfo Limited. And I seek your motion to approve the resolution appointing this new firm.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Oh, yes, John.
Yes, yeah. As President Lamalani mentioned, the legal committee met last week and interviewed the firms that responded to the RFP. I'm not on the legal committee, so I did not interview these firms, and I'm sure that this firm that you are recommending, Mr. President, Otison, Britz, Kelly, Cooper, Gilbert, and DeNolfo Limited is a fine firm. And although I'm not on the committee, I'm not an attorney, in my 15 years on the Fire and Police Commission and now six on the board, 21 years in dealing with village attorneys, I do have some experience dealing with the attorneys. And this will be our third attorney in my 6 years here on the board, six in a few months. My concern is that we have had two excellent firms in the past and have given us excellent service, advice, they've settled lawsuits, and have done it at a very good price. The past $8,500, which I know Mike Manzo was instrumental in getting the retainer and getting it that low. But when these law firms do see the amount of legal work that's actually required on our village, they look at this RFP and they're looking at the hours that we say, oh, this is only going to take this amount of time. And they realize after doing this for 4 years, as in Holland and Knight and Peter Freeman, or Greg Jones and Ansel Glink, they realize, wait a second, this is a lot more than we were led to believe. And I think that this firm and the negotiated price up from $8,500 to $11,000 a month as the retainer reflects the fact that we have a lot.
$10,500.
We have a lot more legal work in this village. And this firm is going to find that out too. And, you know, I just hate to have this musical chairs. Once you get like a firm like Holland and Knight, they get familiar with everyone. There's a trust factor. They understand the community. Same way with Ansel and Clink. I hate to lose that experience, that institutional memory, and then move on to another firm. As I said, this will be the third in my 6 years here. And I'm sure they're well qualified. No doubt about this. However, this musical chairs of legal firms is a concern of mine. Thank you.
As you know, this was a decision of the legal committee, and they did a good job interviewing all the candidates and interviewing the firms that were interested in serving the village of Oak Brook. I agree with you. This is the third legal firm in 9 years. I've been here. This is my ninth year.
Yeah, my
but
six.
For you, it's six. I agree. Yeah. And both preceding firms did a tremendous job. I agree with you there, too. Both Holland and Knight and Ansel Glink and Carl Otterson is here. I would like to recognize him if you would like to stand up and be recognized. You got big shoes to fill here, no doubt about it. And John Bauer is so right as far as the comments that he made. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say yes.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. I do want to take a second to personally and also on behalf of the board thank Ansel Glink, including Stuart Diamond, Carrie Lynn Krafthafer, and of course Greg Jones, who has worked very hard. And all these three attorneys have done a tremendous job over the last 3 years. And you'll be missed. No doubt about it. You've done a lot of work for us, and you've been a tremendous help to the village, and you're very prompt. Whenever I call you, he calls you back the same day, and if he doesn't have the answer, he finds the answer and sends me back the same day. So, and you've done the same thing for the board members as well, so we're going to miss you, no doubt about that. Moving on, just want to make a quick announcement that the Long-Term Strategic Planning Advisory Committee, I was told, as you all know, they were supposed to submit an interim or a preliminary report in August, But as you know, we do not have a second meeting in August, so they will be sending the report in the first meeting in September, the first board meeting in September. They are almost done with the report, and I think they are putting their finishing touches at this time. I'm happy to report to you I've attended all their meetings, as have many of the trustees, and I believe they've worked very hard. Actually, several of the members are here. I see a couple of them here, as well as you're here as well, and thank you for the hard work that you've done. And they've been thinking outside the box and trying to see what they can do to help the village of Oak Brook financially and economically, to see what we can do and how we can work more effectively and better as we face the challenges. The financial challenges are upon us, and I truly appreciate the work of the members of this committee. They've actually divided up in two subgroups right now. They have one committee that deals with finance, and then there's another one that deals with economic matters. And I've attended most of those meetings and all of their general meetings, and I believe one more is coming up on August the 26th. I think that will be one of your last meetings before you present the interim report. And I just want to take a moment to thank them for all the efforts that they've put in. And so many of you are even attending the board meetings, so you get a pulse of what's going on in our community, and I truly appreciate that. And finally, importantly, I'd like to wish all those who celebrate Eid Mubarak. It's a holiday in the Islamic community, the Eid al-Adha. I think Asif would be knowledgeable about that a lot more than I will, as will Moin Syed as well. And I do believe that the festival or the celebration started on Sunday evening, if I'm correct. Am I right, Asif? Yeah, and it goes on till Thursday evening. And it's the most important holiday or holy festival in the Muslim community. And as you know, there are how many, 1.9 million Muslims across the globe? Am I right? The number, is that right, Asif?
Something over a billion.
Yeah, it's over 1.6, yeah. I believe it is. 1.9. And many of them actually live in Oak Brook, and two of them are sitting on a board here. So I'd like to take this opportunity on behalf of the board to join the celebrations. It's supposed to be a festival of sacrifice, as I understand, and maybe Asif will elaborate further during his trustee segments. That concludes my brief president's report. Thank you. Are there any visitor comments, Charlotte?
Ann Hoover is first.
Good evening, gentlemen. My name is Ann Huber. I live at 12 Cambridge in Brook Forest, and I'm just here to commend you all on the resolution with regard to Sterigenics. Many of the residents of Oak Brook are involved in this matter, and we are following it closely, and a number of us are protesting it because we appreciate the science behind it. We all breathe the same air. It doesn't affect just Willowbrook or Burr Ridge or Hinsdale. It blows up here, and there's a triangle of these facilities. So we're hit from a number of different angles, as you may well know. But I just want to express my appreciation for the board taking a position and helping in the effort to confirm that if the facility is reopened, that it actually complies with a consent order, because it was pretty toothless. And we all know that Profit will find a way to eke around void platitudes. So I thank you all for taking a position, and I hope that you will continue to monitor the situation, because it is very, very serious. Thank you.
Any other comments?
Rich Allison. And I have two with on the consent agenda.
Hi, board. Hi. Richard Allison, Charlotte, 31 Robin Hood Ranch, and I've been in the area probably almost 50 years now. I just have a brief event announcement, if you'll bear with me, but prior to that, I got an interesting computer email today from a Mrs. Lamalani. I don't know if she has a relative around here or not, but the thrust of her comment was how useful she found our next-door neighbor intranet that Chief Kruger instigated probably a year or two ago from this very room as a helpful source for police reports and other. Now, it's really a worthwhile thing, so I certainly recommend you sign up with it, if you will. The event is next Friday. I'm sorry for the late notice, but I'm representing the Fullersburg Historic Foundation. Our vision and role is to oversee the Gateway Historic District between Hinsdale and Oak Brook, and that comprises the Faith Fellowship Church, the Growy Mill, the Growy House, your tavern, and the Ben Fuller House. As many of you may know, Ben Fuller came here in the 1830s by horseback from New York, upstate New York, went back, brought his family here, platted some 800 acres called Brush Hill at the time, now called Fullersburg. And what we've done is employ a young man to prepare a light show. I don't know if you've seen Art on the Mart, but downtown at the Merchandise Mart, they have 32 projectors. And they'll be projecting art and a number of venues that are quite interesting. In any case, on the facade of the Ben Fuller House this Friday night, 8 p.m., about an hour show, we'll be showing historic events and places, hotels, and things that existed here well over a century ago. If you go to fullersburg.org, you can download a notice about that and donate if you wish. So that's my brief comment. I will be appearing here, no doubt, again about the Growy Mill Dam, which again is under attack by the County DuPage Stormwater Commission. We successfully beat them back in 2009. And the issue is they want to modify the dam, either tear it out, lower the water, or add an additional spillway. And what's critical here is that the venue there, the ambiance, is what brings 200,000 people out to that area to attend, go to the mill, watch their instructions as they grind the mill, which and I'll be presenting that at the show Friday night. So one of the trustees here happens to be a member of the Stormwater Commission, with whom I've spoken a couple of times and expect to do more. So just want you to know it's in the offing, and I believe that commission is going to make a presentation to the Forest Preserve sometime this fall with specifics about what they would like to do. They addressed us here some months ago, and I got pretty upset. Another government mandate, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, thanks for your time. Maybe we'll see you Friday night. Thank you.
Thank you, Rich.
Any other comments?
No, the other two are with agenda items.
Actually, Ann, your comments reminds me of the email that Ray Seska, as you know, Ray has taken a front line and leadership role on the Sterigenics issue, and he has spoken to the board on a couple of occasions, several occasions, as a matter of fact. And he's out of town this week, and he expressed his regrets that he couldn't join, but he's very appreciative of some of the work that the board has done in its attempt to eliminate the contamination that they have in Willow Brook and the surrounding communities. And I believe the trustees also received such an email. And we'll keep on plugging along to make sure that this contamination ends totally. Thank you. We move on now to the approval of the minutes. May I have a motion for approval of the minutes from the Special Executive Committee meeting June 11, 2019?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say yes.
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 Any objections? Not. Motion carries. Next, may I have a motion for the approval of the minutes from the regular Board of Trustees meeting of July 9, 2019?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say yes.
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 Motion carries. I would now kindly request that you direct your attention to the screen where the consent agenda is available for your viewing. Does any board member wish to have any item removed from the consent agenda? Yes, Trustee
Randall. D1.
D1. Any others?
Yes.
Yes.
A2 yeah. and 7.
Yeah, pardon?
A2 and 7.
A2 and 7.
Okay.
Any other extractions? Seeing none, may I have a motion to approve the consent agenda except for the extractions and authorize the expenditures as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Passes.
Motion carries, yeah. John, would you want to
yes.
take these two items?
I move to approve agenda items A2 and A7, Atlas Bobcat in the amount of $40,994 and Burris Equipment $25,604.
Second.
Discussion?
Yeah, I'd just like an explanation from our Golf Operations Director on what these items are.
The first one, A2, is a skid steer loader. It does many things at the golf course. It has forklifts, it has a trencher, it has mainly a bucket to load sand to get us out to the golf course and do a lot of big jobs on the golf course and projects.
What did you call it again?
A skid steer loader.
Skid steer motor. So it's like a Bobcat?
Correct. Exactly a Bobcat.
That's just a brand name, Bobcat.
Yes.
Okay.
A7 is a utility vehicle that gets the crew around the golf course. It carries many different pieces of equipment. You can tow things with it. You put sand in it. You can put mulch in it, things in that nature.
Okay. That's like... you were getting a lot of John Deere pieces of equipment. Is this John Deere?
No, this is Ransom's version of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
They gave you the best price?
Better price, yeah.
Okay. I would just want to comment two things to you. I think there needs to be closer coordination between Public Works and our sports corps. And I think the reason why our sports corps is starting to turn around is because the village has embraced the sports corps and we're working as a team. Public Works is in there taking care of the B&T and many other things. And we didn't have that before. It was like the sports corps was over there, you know, take care of yourself. And as long as we don't hear any problems, that, you know, that's fine. So I think that a coordination of pieces of equipment and inventory needs to be done so that we don't have a duplication of pieces of equipment. I understand a Bobcat, you use that all the time. You know, you can't just go over to the Public Works garage and say, oh, I need it for this whole week or something else like that. I mean, you need to have that. Gator, the same thing. Having said that, too, I would like to see a complete inventory of all the equipment there. And when we keep on buying equipment, there has to be something that goes out the door, surplus equipment. We just got rid of a fire department trailer, a ambulance. We have two trucks out there still trying to find homes for, probably as junk. But we need to get a handle on what we have as equipment, what we need, and then have a plan of replacement, just like we do with our entire fleet. And what I'm asking you to do is coordinate with Public Works and put this all together so that there's a complete picture and that we're really working as a team and the sports corps and the village is brought together to make the sports corps as successful as possible.
Any further discussion?
That's my comment.
I believe we can take both these items together, so can I have a roll call vote?
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
He stepped out.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Okay, so I've got four votes.
All right. Motion carries. Item D1, Trustee Manzo?
Move the authorization to conduct the request of proposal process for the sale of non-resident portions of the village's water system.
Second.
Thank you. This, Tony, this is what we were doing, I think, several months ago. Looking at maybe buyers for the non-residential portion of our water system.
This is Doug.
To be honest, I haven't really been involved with this one.
Oh, Doug, I'm sorry, yes. Doug. My bad.
Yes. This is exactly what we've been discussing for about 2 years. That we've gone through looking at surrounding communities mm-hmm. that touch these areas to see if there was interest. We had about a year and a half of discussions with those communities. They came back and said that it didn't work for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so we talked about reaching out to private companies. And we found that the private companies are interested in buying into mm-hmm. the system. And had a discussion with DuPage Water Commission, and it will help our allocation with what we have right now. Depending on how this goes, we potentially could take out a well house that we maintain now, less required maintenance on some other facilities, and it draws in to where the village water system only maintains inside the corporate limits. Right now, from day one, when the original water system was built, Paul Butler, Oak Brook Utility Company, went for customers.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't matter where they were. If you wanted water, he would send pipes out there. So we go way out beyond our corporate limits. We go through other communities to serve water to unincorporated areas. So this brings everything back in within our corporate limits. So all the money that we spend on the water system is for our corporate system.
And I mean, Doug, you know how I feel about this. I mean, you and I have gone back and forth for several years on this. And obviously there's financial benefit to doing this, you know, less expenditures for us. I'll just put my position out there. To sell to a private vendor, private company would be something I think that would work out badly for us. It's worked out badly for our neighbors when they've done it. Selling it to another municipality is something that could possibly, you said they're not interested in it for obvious reasons. But there is some influence that comes with having this system. And we've already used it a couple times where development right on our border, not in our community, but just outside of it, something we weren't happy with, we were able to flex some leverage and not provide the water. And that way, we have protections on our borders and beyond our borders. But I just wanted to put it out there. I'll try to keep an open mind on this. I will, Doug.
Thank you.
I will. But I would prefer going to a governmental agency, because when you go to that private company is buying that with the intent of making a profit, which they should. And then in the long run, they make a bad situation worse. And I know they're not our residents, but I still feel some obligation to them.
When we started looking at private companies, I was kind of on the wall. Looking at the volume of customers that they have in the state, in the nation, you're gonna see a lot more of this coming.
I know.
And it's not just going to be certain areas. You're going to see smaller communities are already going to this because they get rid of the liability. They still serve the water. So it'll be an interesting process.
No. Thank you, Doug.
Any further discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Okay, motion carries. Next, item agenda 8. Trustee Manzo, would you present the Christchurch of Oak Brook final plat of the re-subdivision, final plat for a two-lot subdivision, and make the appropriate motion?
Okay. The motion for Christ Church of Oak Brook, 501 Oak Brook Road, CCOB, final plat of re-subdivision, final plat for two-lot subdivision. I don't have it on my screen.
I got it.
Any?
1 second. He didn't read the full. He didn't read the full motion.
What page is that on, Greg?
Yeah, I'm looking.
Lost it.
If anyone has it electronically, you might be able to flip to it faster.
Here you go.
I'm having a problem with my electronic version, too.
Thank you, John.
I can't even find it yet.
It's it's here. It's a page two further down than it should be.
We got it. Thank you.
Thank you to John. I move that the Village Board concur with the recommendation of the Plan Commission to approve the proposed two-lot CCOB final plat of resubdivision subject to, one, final engineering approval prior to recordation of the plat, and authorizing the village attorney to prepare the necessary resolution.
Thank you, John.
Okay.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Okay.
Dave Melvin would like to speak.
Yeah.
He signed
Dave?
Up.
Just to be of service.
Please come forward. We can't hear you without the microphone.
Thank you, President Lamalani.
Welcome
Village
aboard.
Board. I just want to be here to be of service if you have any questions. Love to see that beautiful piece of property. Now that we have a beautiful parking lot that provides porosity so that we have rainwater going right into the earth, right through our parking lot, we don't need that extra lot at the south end. It can go back on the tax rolls. We're happy to turn that over. And this subdivision will allow us to put it on the market.
Thank you. Any comments?
Nope.
Seeing none, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Mansell?
Yes.
It passes.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for joining us, and you're welcome to stay for the rest of the meeting. It gets more interesting.
So. It's riveting.
Next, Trustee Barr, would you present Resolution R-1818?
This is a resolution to approve a successor agreement between the Village of Oak Brook and the Fraternal Order of Police Labor Council. I move that the Village Board approve Resolution 2019-CNTRCT-PD-FOP-R-1818 to authorize the Village President to sign and the Village Clerk to attest to a successor agreement between the Village of Oak Brook and the Fraternal Order of Police, FOP Labor Council.
Second.
Second. Discussion?
Compound.
Yes, Trustee Mansell?
Yeah, a couple comments, some concerns. I know, Chief, you spoke to us in closed session on this. You've answered some of my questions via email. Thank you for that. I applaud the Chief for being proactive and keeping and attracting the best in law enforcement, and that's what we want in Oak Brook. We want the best, we want the brightest, so I'm glad he did this. I guess some of my comments is, you know, hopefully we could get something in return from the unions regarding this. Is this something that is going to help us in negotiations? Is there some other concessions maybe with management rights that we can get in lieu of this financial incentive that we're giving them?
We got a significant health insurance concession that is going to save the village thousands and thousands of dollars from here on out and put everyone, all employees, on an equal footing. So
we're all at 20% now? Or?
Yes.
Okay.
And I think it was a very amicable agreement that was a win-win for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And being able to have the officers agree to the insurance concessions, considering it was something that they had won in arbitration two contracts ago, I think was a huge show of support and good faith on their part as well.
Yeah, and I think that's a nice concession. I know in the long run it's still going to cost us some money, but to the point that Gopal, you and I discussed, now we just have to tighten our belts with the budget process. This is something now moving forward. I don't remember the number exactly, Chief. Was it by 2020 it'd be 100,000 or 21?
Well, two things on that. And one thing that Jason did a great job putting together that little spreadsheet. One thing that there's a realization that this is really a break-in cost. It's not a perpetual cost because officers are getting to the same top pay they would have gotten to anyway. So there's a break-in cost, so they get the top pay sooner, mm-hmm. but it doesn't go higher than it would have anyway.
Yeah, no, it stops once it gets there, but as right, you're going exactly. through the process, though, it would...
So it's just that time period. It's just that time period.
Till you the get other to, thing... Till you to, get into the top pay. Okay.
Correct. The other thing is that actually, by doing this, we actually averted losing a very good tenured four-year officer, which, as you saw in the discussions that we had, the cost of turnover is in excess of $100,000 for just one officer. Mm-hmm. So we've already recouped the cost back in just
And I noticed in the proposal, if I read it correctly, it's retroactive. Our labor attorney says we can do that, or...
No, it's not retroactive.
It's not retroactive?
No, it starts September 1st.
Oh, not January 1st.
No.
Where did you read that? Okay.
No, so we're in really good shape.
Okay. All right, thank you.
John?
Yes. What this contract does is allow us to be competitive with many other police departments out there. And what it does is just shrink the number of years between the beginning base salary and the top salary. Which what we were seeing is that we were losing people even before we hired them to other departments and losing people that we did hire to other departments. And it costs $100,000 to train one police officer. And just going through the Fire and Police Commission, that process is very expensive. So retaining these police officers in this manner is very good. The other thing that we got from this, and this was a win-win, we have always had a problem with our health insurance, our major medical, and not dovetailing the police and the fire and everyone else. And this has cost us money every single year when we go, our broker goes out, Brian Schwartz goes out and asks for bids on our health care. Now we're going to be at par between everyone else. And this is going to help save on our major medical. So that was a major win on our part. I do want to compliment Rick Jennings. I know it's a long day. Rick Jennings and our chief for the professionalism that they've had built up within this department, because both sides came from a position of trust. It wasn't a us against them. You know, it wasn't staking out very polar positions and trying to whittle something into the middle, which we've often seen in labor negotiations. You sat down and just said, look, here's the solution to this. Let's just talk about it. What can you accept here? What can you give us? And you made it happen. So I congratulate you and your Rick Jennings and the team for doing a fantastic job and getting this contract extended to 2023.
Any other comments?
It also saved us money in legal fees. We avoided an arbitration where we would have paid our attorneys. And it could have been a long, drawn-out one with a worse result. So they should receive our accommodation for that, too, that you guys did that and also maintain the level in which our citizens expect from our police department is getting the best officers that we can get, especially with getting the Heinz development coming in, with getting other things. We can't have them, and I know the chief has repeatedly said he's having trouble not just getting the recruits but keeping them. And hopefully this tool will give him what he needs to bring these younger ones in. This won't affect any of the older officers at all. They're already at that top pay. It's not going to affect them. It's for the young guys to attract them in.
Any other comments? Yeah, Asif?
Real briefly. Yeah, we had to be competitive. Otherwise, we end up with a revolving door. You bring somebody in, They're going through the hiring process. Somebody else calls with a quicker progression to top of pay. Or you hire them, you train them, and the process is pretty extensive. You have the academy, then you have field training time, and then you have additional time before an officer is truly seasoned. And after we've invested all this time and money, they go to another department because the package is more attractive. And the costs are substantial, as it's been said. This allows us to stay competitive in the marketplace to have people, because when you don't have people, you need people on the street. That leads to overtime. So we were compelled to do this, and part of it's a function of the good economy we're in.
Okay. Any other comments? I do appreciate all the comments made, and I appreciate, Jason, your further analysis of our expense on this issue. But as we start spending more money, let's remember now that the budget season is coming up on us, let's also try to think about minimizing or trimming expenses. And I'm counting on the village manager and the departmental directors and you, Jim Kruger, to have across the board 5 to 10% reduction in your budgetary requirements. I made that plea last year. Nobody listened to me. I'm making this plea again this year, and please listen to me, because you know the financial challenges on our neck, which is the reason why we created this committee to find ways and means of reducing expenses. And this is my plea to each departmental director, that as we spend more money where we need to, here we didn't have a choice, Chief, on other areas, let's be a little careful about expenses. May I have a roll call vote?
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Mansell?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
That's it. 5-0 passes.
Okay. Next is 9B, which is the reason why we need to trim expenses. Trustee Mansell, would you present the 2019 pension funding matter?
Is this Jason? You could
Jason
take it.
Would do it?
This is obviously...
Passing it out to him?
Yeah. What page is that on? Is that a resolution?
Page 456.
Jason,
456?
Go ahead and take the lead, Jason.
Okay. So back in March, we presented the village actuary results for 2019. So what tonight we have is to actually approve the funding rate for 2019. We have Department of Insurance recommendations for funding, and then we have each of the, both the police and the fire pension fund, their recommendation or their request for funding. So I laid that out in the memo. On the police side, our village actuary said $2,057,112. The pension fund's asking for $2,226,000. A couple, things to note here is, even though you see the pension fund is using a 6.5% investment rate versus the village is using the higher 6.75%. Our recommendation is actually coming in higher than on the pension fund side, primarily due to the payroll growth. They're using 3.75% versus 2.75% on ours. In talking with our actuary, if we actually increased ours by the 1% to match up with them, it would lower our contribution by $130,000. So that's kind of why, even though they're using a higher, a slightly lower rate than ours is actually coming in higher than theirs, because there's some other play and some of the other assumptions going on.
And there's a $130,000 difference there?
If we bumped up our rate to theirs, but all that would do, would lower it today, bump it up later, so.
Okay.
And then on the fire side, you'll see our actuary said $2,150,000. The pension fund is asking for $2,618,000. So they came in considerably higher. Some of the reasons for that would be they're using a slightly, 0.25% interest rate lower. They're using a new mortality table, which assumes longer life. So assume people live longer and then we're paying pensions longer.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're also assuming that 85% of the population is married versus we assume 80%. So they're, assuming, since I can't remember the number, but it assumes that the spouses are younger than the actual participants. So that's just longer than we're paying spousal benefits for. So that's kind of why theirs is coming in significantly higher than ours. So what the recommendation we're going to make is similar to what we've done in the past. We adopt, since we're a percentage of payroll, and we just pay by each, by, you know, how much people make per payroll, we pay them. We adopt the Department of Insurance numbers on a you know, per payroll one, and then we kind of make a annual contribution at the end to kind of make whole with what our actuary says.
And Jason, I guess I'll make the motion now because I have a quick question. I move that the Village Board approve a Village payroll contribution rate of 50.59% for police pension members and 64.35% for fire pension members, retroactive to January 1st, 2019.
Second.
Thank you.
Further discussion?
Why the difference between the two groups? It's just is there because one's at 50 and one's at 64. Is that just because the benefits or the investments or?
It's just kind of where each of them is funded. The percentage funded. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, fire is less funded than the police pensions, so they need more to kind of make up. So.
Did you say the firemen are living longer than the policemen?
No, I'm saying the assumptions they're using are a different mortality table that assumes people in general are living longer.
Oh, I see. Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. Mr. President.
Yeah. John.
Yes. I would be more comfortable really going with the village attorney's actuary. I think that the what you have here is the Illinois Department of Insurance recommendation, and that's projected unit credit 90% by 2040. Is that correct?
So why we go with that is we're on a percentage of payroll. So if we went with the village, the village actuary numbers and did that as a percentage of payroll, if for some reason we came in over budget, you know, salary wise, we would contribute more, you know, we'd be putting in more. So what we're saying is we're going to, on a per payroll, we're going to shoot lower and then make it up, you know, at the end to kind of equal that number so that we don't go over that number.
We've done that in past years. Where we
So
we could make it the village actuary one. We would run a chance potentially of just going over that number since we're doing it, you know, a percentage of each payroll.
So that I'd like to ask if Trustee Manzo would accept a friendly amendment to his that we do, we commit ourselves using the percentages that he moved, but commit ourselves to funding at 100% at the end of the year.
The plan is last year to come back.
We'll make the adjustment.
Make that part of the motion.
Yes, that I accept the friendly amendment, and then we can make the adjustments at the end of the year like we normally do regarding that.
I'll bring back another memo in December, with my best guess of how much the extra will be.
We all realize that pensions are a problem. Yeah. And if we don't do it 100%, then this figure is going to balloon much higher than it should be, and we need to manage it responsibly year after year. And if we do that, we can manage the pension costs in this village.
Any further discussion?
Agree.
Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Syed?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Motion carries. Information and updates, Rick?
Thank you. Well, kind of bittersweet, but on behalf of the staff and I really want to personally thank Stuart Diamond, Kelly Lynn Krafthuffer, and of course, Greg Jones for all the demanding work that they've done for us since 2016. And we had a vast array of legal issues we all worked on. We all spent a great deal of time on telephones, whether it was here or at home, on weekends or in evenings. And as President Lamalai said, you were always there to answer the phone calls anytime. I think you were even on vacation a few times when I talked to him, both Maybe. You and I. But I also want to thank, there were a number of other attorneys from their firm that really helped this village and did a great deal for us during that time. David Warner. With his insight on our liquor license and liquor laws when Kathy or Charlotte had questions for him. Keith Aspruth, he was here for a number of planning, ZBA, Plan Development Commission meetings. And Tony had a lot of interaction with him. And then Adam Simon, I know, worked with Jim a lot on our wireless communication agreements. So all the work was much appreciated, and I think Oak Brook's a better place for your work. So thank you very much.
Thanks for the kind words. I'll pass that along to the team.
Thank you. Charlotte, any updates?
I don't have anything other than say dittos to Rick's memo. The lawyers were extremely good to us, and I appreciate it because we had accurate records that way.
Trustee update, Asif.
Well, you know, again, Greg, it's been a pleasure working with you and your firm over all this time. You've conducted yourself in a very professional manner. You've spoken with knowledge behind your words, and that is a major attribute. So thank you for
Moyne,
any all
parting
your years
words,
to the
Moyne?
Village.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Thank you.
On another note, yes, the Muslim community did celebrate the Eid al-Adha, or the Feast of the Sacrifice, Sunday or Monday. It's on a lunar calendar, so depending on where you are in the world, if you see the new moon. And it's to commemorate when God commanded Abraham to sacrifice his son, and God put a sheep in his place. So for each member of the family, we sacrifice a goat or a lamb, or you can do a cow that counts as seven. There's six of us in the house, so we do one, and we donate it all to charity. You're allowed to do one-third to charity, one-third to friends and family, one-third for yourself, but there's such a great need out there. We just do the whole thing. So it was a happy celebration. It didn't go on till Thursday. For us, it pretty much ended Sunday night, but it was a nice day with family, and we're back to work. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm fine tonight. No?
John, any comments?
Yeah, I want to commend the board of supporting the Stop Sterigenics. I think that we represent most of our citizens when we do something like that, noting that many of our students go to school much closer. We may be farther away, but our students go much closer, whether it's their high school or whether they compete at a high school that's right in the backyard of Sterigenics. So I commend the board on that. My wife and I have been longtime members of Fullersburg Stork Foundation members. I urge the rest of the board to get behind them, join. I might see you this Friday there. They always put on a great event. Greg, thank you very much, and thank your colleagues. You've given us great representation and have done it in such a way that you kept us out of trouble, but you were strong in telling us what was right. And I commend you for that.
Good job.
And then Eid Mubarak to all the Muslim citizens in Oak Brook, Asif, Feast of the Sacrifice and the story of Abraham and his sacrificing his son is something, a story that we share.
Absolutely.
Christians, Jews, and Muslims. So it's something that unites us, and we need to look for more opportunities of those items that unite us rather than divide us.
You know, real briefly, if I can add one thing to that, I think if you look at people, you'll see that they're in agreement 98% of the time. So in life, we can either focus on the 98 or we can focus on the two. I think the 98 is more productive for everyone.
Good point, yeah. Focus on what binds
on
us
the common
together.
Ground.
Yeah. Thank you. Good point, yeah.
I'll start off my comments with Greg Jones. And Greg, I do want to absolutely thank you for your service. You came at a very tumultuous time. There were a lot of concerns, and I think you righted the ship and you calmed the waters. Obviously, you know my feelings. And I thought once you came in, you saved the account and you did fine work for us. And I thank you for that. Regarding the development, I think with all these developments going on, I think we have an opportunity here in Oak Brook to beautify some of the areas that have been maybe somewhat neglected, be it by the mall, be it by the corners of 83 and 22nd. And Tony, I hope, I know you and I have had numerous conversations on this. If we can work in concert with some of these developers and beautify those areas, high traffic areas, I think would be good. I think to John's point on the tollway, could be, we could use a lot of improvement beautifying there. Let's be careful. Right now, it seems like there's a frenzy going on with developers wanting to come into Oak Brook and shoehorn their development somewhere into Oak Brook, putting square pegs into round holes. Let's be careful. Let's be diligent in our work and make sure that it fits for us and it doesn't change the character of Oak Brook. And then lastly, Doug, I'm sure you and I will be having future conversations regarding the water system. So we have to be careful with that move also. Thank you.
Thank you. Greg, today you'll have to say something.
Suppose I do.
Usually he skips us, you know, he just ignores us and skips. Well, but today it's a special
the meetings are so verbose. What else can be said? Thank you, everyone, for the kind words. It's been an enjoyable few years. Rick, you have a world-class staff. Each and every person sitting at this table and a lot of people that aren't sitting there. And Kathy sitting behind the table.
Where is she? I can't even see her, yeah.
An incredible group of dedicated professionals. The Village is lucky to have each and every one of you, and I feel fortunate to have had the opportunity to work with you. So I wish the Village luck, and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. You never know, our paths might cross again. Village President usually yields to Jim.
A couple quick updates on the cellular communication projects on the consent agenda tonight. The board approved the T-Mobile cellular site going to the East Water Tower, which is on Windsor Drive. The nice thing about that project is in addition to the well house that we worked with Doug and the Public Works crew, it'll remodel about a 50-year-old well house, I believe, and add cellular equipment and also the ability to add an additional carrier down the road. And all that construction was at no cost to the Village. The cell tower here at the Village Hall, T-Mobile will have their equipment live by the end of the month. So if you're a T-Mobile customer, we're adding a couple sites within the next month or so. And for Greg, it's been great working with you. But your colleague, Adam Simon, as Rick mentioned, Adam did a tremendous job with us, not only with the cellular communications, but with Tony's department, with all the micro cells being deployed. Adam's an expert on the micro cells, so it was great working with him as well.
I'll pass that along.
Chief?
Thank you. Just a couple quick things. One is we had a phenomenal national night out with well over 400 in attendance. It was a great event. We had good food donated and a lot of wonderful activities for the kids. So we can't wait to do it again next year. And just it was the staff as well as the community really loved it. The other just a reminder, our Special Olympics golf outing is August 19th, and there's still room, so please, if anybody's interested to golf, please let us know.
While I was out of town for a wedding in Huntington Beach, one of the Oak Brook families had a wedding there. I had a couple of calls from Trinity Lakes. Would you update the board and the residents about what's going on? There's so much fear and scare and on some of these issues that are happening there.
Well, Oak Brook, as well as all the surrounding communities, had some experiences with either auto theft or burglary to motor vehicles. And again, they were unlocked vehicles or vehicles with their keys left in them. And just an understanding is something that I've been concerned about. It have been warning residents about for over a year now. Is that even if you have one in the driveway and you leave it unlocked, there's probably a door opener in that car, which then they can get in the garage. And that was one case where they stole the vehicle that was in the garage because it was a newer vehicle. The vehicles have been recovered, and they're all recovered, you know, in the western part of Chicago, the near west side, off the Eisenhower. We're working with the HOA and having conversations with them as far as doing more with crime prevention and talking to the residents and working with them to help us help them by locking their vehicles. And I've also directed our officers to do more directed patrols so that way they see the police more in the neighborhood as well.
Could we have our HALO officers be more engaged? Because the two board members who called me, they didn't even know who their HALO officer was. And
yeah, there was just
get involved and go to their meetings and so on and so forth. And
yeah, I've already talked to their issues. Yeah. I've already talked to them that several of us are going to go to their next HOA meeting. Our HALO officer will reach out, and then they just have to let us know when those meetings are. And I plan to attend the next one as well. We just had personnel changes too, and as you know, with the myriad of hiring and retirements and people leaving and all the problems that we've had with staffing, as Trustee Barr mentioned, is that a lot of those HALO officers had just been assigned or had just changed subdivisions and so forth. So that's all starting to settle down now, and as a matter of fact, the website was updated just a couple days ago to update showing which officer has which subdivision. So their contact information is in there as well. But the staffing has been a very deep concern over the last year. But at least now we're seeing the light at the end of the tunnel.
And they should visit the other the subdivisions
absolutely.
You know, I know in the Hunter Trails meetings that I've gone there, I don't think anybody even knows who the HALO officer is.
Well, we always offer. We always offer sometimes.
Get invited. Just come there, basically, and say a few words. And the same things that you've been talking about, keep your doors locked. And more important than locking the door is you don't keep your garage door opener.
Yeah.
In
right,
an unlocked
exactly.
car, and
we
that's
do,
an invitation for big things. Even the board members are not aware of this.
We do a huge amount of social media, too, and have really been getting the word out. So
yeah,
it's,
thank you. Thank you for the
absolutely.
Effort, Jeff.
Thank
Doug?
You.
We're in the dog days of summer, so wrapping up a lot of projects, trying to get ready to start the summer, fall restorations. I just wanted to let you know, Brook Forest Water Main Project, the water mains are installed, all the residents are hooked up, the road patching is done, we'll be doing restorations again with the dog days of summer. We don't want to be planting grass during the hot season, so we'll be prepping everything and getting ready first for planting seed in September, depending on weather. But we're also starting the next phase of the water main projects. Within a couple weeks, we'll be working on Luthen Road, and then we're going to Enterprise to Clearwater, and then Windsor at the end of the year.
Thank you. John?
So we've had a really good stretch of weather, which means we have a lot of happy golfers. This past weekend, we just had our yearly golf club championship. I'd like to give a shout out to a few guys, Justin Widd, Dan Younglove, Sam Menton, Bill Brandenburg, and Sam Lacani. Congratulations for winning your respective flights. Thank you.
Hats off to you on those beautiful outings you've had for many of us in the evenings that you do here.
Very nice.
Those are turning out very well.
Very positive comments.
There's another one coming up next month.
Even the non-golfers are coming, you know, as you know.
That's also great to
Having
see.
A lot
yes.
of fun, yeah. When is your next one?
Next month it was... I think it's the middle of September, but we're still working on it.
Okay. Thank you. Jake?
I just want to let you know that the library's summer reading for the kids has wrapped up, and this year, Teresa and her staff, they surpassed over 300 kids signing up for summer reading, which is great. That's the largest number we've had, and it keeps kids engaged all summer and sends them to school prepared, and so I just want to let you know about that and congratulate Teresa and her staff on doing a great job.
Yes, Kathy?
The sales tax collections for August of this year were about 0.4% higher than August of last year. So year to date, first 8 months of the year, we're about 2.4% higher than we were the first 8 months of last year. And it's about $240,000 over where we kind of budgeted for this year. So things are looking good 8 months through the year.
For the sales tax year?
Yes.
Thank you. Barry?
Nothing.
Tony?
Just another thank you to Greg Jones, Kurt Asproof, and Adam Simon for all the assistance they've provided the Development Service Department over the last 2 years since I've been here. Thanks, Greg.
Thank you. Thank you for the good work you do, Tony. Thank you. May I now have a motion to adjourn the regular meeting August 13, 2019?
So move. Second.
Second. All those in favor say yes?
Yes.
Any objections? Motion carries. Thank you.
And the time is 8:38 p.m.